station. Give me Memphis, Tennessee. Help me find the party. Try to get in touch with me. She could not leave her number, but I know who placed the call. 'Cause my uncle took the message and he wrote it on the wall.
Welcome to today's edition of Give Me Memphis. I'm Kevin Kane with the Convention and Visitors Bureau. Today we're going to take a look at a person's life who literally changed American culture in the 20th century. Known the world over by his first name, he's regarded as one of the most important figures of 20th century popular culture. I'm talking about none other than the king of rock and roll himself, Elvis Presley. Today, we'll meet some of those closest to the king as they share their memories of what made Elvis so special, not only to them, but to the world. What better place to reflect on the legend of Elvis Presley on the 30th anniversary of his death, right here at his home in Graceland.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in?
Joining us now is one of the legendary Memphis Mafia, a person who was one of Elvis's closest friends, someone who actually lived here at Graceland for over a decade and worked for Elvis for over 25 years, Jerry Schilling. Jerry, thank you for joining us today on Give Me Memphis, and welcome back home.
It's a real pleasure, my friend.
I know being in this house brings back some very special memories for you since you actually lived here.
You know, Kevin, as we were just saying, you think of Graceland as this rock and roll place, and some nights it was, but it's the most peaceful, calm place, safest place I ever lived in my life.
Of course, we're here in the music room, and you said Elvis had some very private moments here. Talk about some
of
those.
Well, you know, in 1964, I just moved in a couple of weeks, and it's like in the morning. Nobody's up in the morning, so I hear that. I'm downstairs in my bedroom. I hear this music. So I figure, is there a radio on? So I go upstairs, and Elvis is playing that piano, and he's singing, "You'll Never Walk Alone." And it was so powerful. When I walked in there, and he looked up, it scared me because I thought I interrupted this great moment. And he just went and kept on singing. And there were some great musical moments in this room. It's called the music room for a reason.
Talk about the kind of the camaraderie side of being one of Elvis's friends, not just working for Elvis, but being one of Elvis's friends.
Well, you know, Kevin, I had known Elvis for 10 years, from 54 to 64. Before I went to work for him, my senior year in college. When you went to work for him and you became part of the Memphis Mafia, then you were actually family. You were treated like family. It wasn't like, here's the boss and here's the guys. I mean, we worked together, we played together, we laughed together, we cried together. It was truly about as close as you could get to family.
What was it like when you lived here with the fans? I guess 24 hours a day there was somebody lurking outside those gates or on the other side of that wall just hoping to catch a glimpse of Elvis and all the guys out in the yard or doing something. I mean, what was that like?
Well, you know, what I loved about Elvis, that Elvis loved being Elvis. I think he wouldn't have been as happy if there weren't fans when we drove through that gate. You know, you see stars today and, they run from the fans and all of this. Elvis worked very hard to become Elvis Presley. He worked very hard to have the fans love him. And he really appreciated it. There was a real relationship between Elvis and the fans. And, you know, it's a funny thing, Kevin. After Elvis is gone, and some of us people that, because the fans know that we were close to Elvis and stuff, and now I understand that feeling that Elvis had for his fans.
You just completed a book in the last year, Me and a Guy Named Elvis by Jerry Schilling. And tell me, over the last year, what's been the most gratifying feeling you've had as a result of being able to tell these innermost moments and stories in book form for the world to see?
To be real honest, Kevin, the most gratifying was there was one person that I didn't want to hurt. And my book was unauthorized because I just wanted to tell my story from a kid growing up with Elvis and what our life was. And I asked Lisa if she would read it. And she said, Jerry Schilling, I've only read one book about my father, and my mother wrote it, but I'll read your book. She has a great sense of humor, so I get this email after she, in red, I read your book, and then it turned to green. And she said I had captured her father's spirit as nobody else. That was the most gratifying. I didn't, after that, what the critics said or didn't say, and thank God they liked it too, but that was the most rewarding thing to me that could have happened after I finished that book.
Tell us something about, if Elvis could say, there's one thing about me that, you know, nobody, you know, a lot of people don't know.
Well, you know, I think the thing that would be most important to him is the love that he still generates around the world. You know, he really wanted to be accepted, he wanted to be loved, and I think that was his real motivation. You know, when I left here on the day of the funeral, and we drove down Elvis Presley Boulevard, I will never forget, Kevin. And that's when I knew Elvis had accomplished what he set out to do. There were people lined up on this street, old people, young people, black people, white people, bikers, police, all just in honor of him. And I realized, you know what? He really set out and did what he tried to do. He brought people together all over the world. And that's why people still love him. That's why we're celebrating 30 years. I cannot believe 30 years. It just seems like it was yesterday.
Well, we thank you for joining us today and continued best wishes on the success of this great masterpiece of capturing the true essence and the spirit of Elvis Presley in your book, Me and a Guy Named Elvis. We're going to take another tour in the house. We're going to be joined by another one of Elvis's confidants from the early days, someone who went to junior high school with Elvis and kind of, like Jerry, knew the king before he was a king.